Aloft and away, I shall soar on my wings. Aloft and away, I shall fly.
Evening, everybody. Thanks for turning up. Nice to have an audience. We're going to be talking about thermal soaring. And it's a bit of a mixture between myself and Mike Tomlinson. Mike is doing the meaty bit in the middle, and I'm doing the fluffy bit around the edges. So. Okay, so let's see where we go. Thermal soaring, so what's it all about? Well, we've aimed this talk really at bronze, silver, and 100K diploma. Hotshot cross-country pilots, they probably won't learn anything new, but you'd be welcome to chip in with any discussions that are going on. There's a few conversions on some of the slides, converting knots to kph. To keep the mental arithmetic simple, I've kept it at 2:1. It makes the sums easy, and for the numbers that we're dealing with, the speeds we're flying at, it's a nice easy conversion to do. It's not strictly accurate, but it's close enough for our purposes. Please feel free to ask questions, anything you don't understand as we go along. The fire exit, health and safety, is at the back, so... I'm glad you're reading, so... Okay, why do we need to climb efficiently? We could all probably come up with quite a few reasons there. Staying airborne, exploiting weak conditions, getting home, making the most of the day. A thermal day typically lasts, on a good day, maybe 6 hours, maybe a bit longer on a really good day. If you're going to fly a 500K task, you've got to really be starting quite early and finishing quite late. So it means working in weak conditions. The difference really between a 300 task and a 500 is that 300 takes 4.5 hours and the 500 will take 7 hours. So you've got to use the weak conditions either end of the day. Being a good thermal pilot will help to increase your cross-country speed, which sometimes that seems a bit of a strange thing to understand. So we'll look at that. If we have a look at a glider polar, which I'm sure we're all familiar with. Isn't it nice when the graphics work? This doesn't apply to any particular glider. It's just a shape which I pulled up. But if we're climbing at 2 knots and we strike a tangent from 2 knots down to the polar, where our tangent crosses the speed line, this would be our average cross-country speed. So if we then put a tangent down from 4 knots, you can see we've actually got quite a significant increase in our cross-country speed by climbing more efficiently. And some numbers there you can have a look at. Again, the 2:1 conversion is coming to play there. We can look at it a bit more brutally, if you like. If you think of a 100K triangle, if we use the 10K per 1,000 feet, to get around a 100K triangle, we're going to need 10,000 feet of climb. If we say we're going to cruise around our 100K triangle at 50 knots, 100 kph, the cruise time is going to take about an hour to get around this triangle. So if we climb at 10 knots, which is nice, we'll be 10 minutes in the climb. So our flight time now is going to be the 1 hour plus the 10 minutes, gives a speed of 86 kph. Okay. If we now climb at 1 knot, that's going to be 100 minutes of climb time added to the 1 hour of the cruise. 2 hours, 40 minutes, our speed is 38 kph. So a big difference there in the speed around the triangle. If we look at more sensible speeds, we've got a 2-knot climb there, which will then give us a speed of 55 kph. And a 4-knot climb, we're looking at a speed of 71 kph. So there's quite a difference there. Obviously, other things will come into play. If you start talking about MacCready, if you get a better climb, you're going to cruise faster. But I just wanted to make the example of a better climb will improve your cross-country speed. What do we mean by average climb? Well, while we're on a cross-country flight, we're going to be cruising, climbing, and we're not really doing anything else on a cross-country. So the time we take to measure our average climb is taken from the time when we stop cruising to when we start cruising. So all the time from there to there is going to affect our average climb. So if we've got poor technique at the bottom of the thermal, we're not centering quickly enough, we might well have a 4-knot thermal here, but if we mess around at the bottom, that 4-knot thermal very quickly becomes a 3-knot thermal. And similarly, if we faff around at the top of the climb, through poor planning, poor decision making, our 3-knot thermal now becomes a 2-knot thermal. Excuse me. So we can improve the climbs that are out there. So how do we climb efficiently? Well, there's the bad news. There's no easy fix. The likes of Andy Davis and the Jones brothers, they've been working long and hard to be good thermal pilots. It doesn't come easily, and you have to work at it. It needs hard work, it needs a lot of concentration, and it needs lots of practice as well. When Mike comes onto his talk, he's going to be talking about the feel of thermals. And it's those last 3 points there that you need to work on to develop a feel with the thermals. We need to centre quickly, which Mike will be talking about. We need to leave promptly. We need to turn tightly as well. And again, Mike's going to dwell on that, but I'm going to put my two penneth in here as well. Most glider pilots don't turn tight enough. And also most glider pilots, they think they're turning a lot tighter than what they actually are. So we need to work on this turning tightly business. This is a polar for circling flight for a standard class glider. Down the side we've got sink rate in knots, and along the top we've got a turning radius in feet. So if we're banked at 20 degrees and we're cruising at 50 knots, our turn radius is going to be almost 600 feet for the radius, and our sink rate is going to be pretty much the same as it would be with wings level. But if we increase our angle of bank to 40 degrees of bank, our sink rate now has gone to 1.7 knots. We've made the sink rate worse by just half a knot, which is no big deal really. But look at what we've done to the radius of the turn. It's less than half of what we had when we're turning at 20 degrees angle of bank. So it really does make a big difference to how close you get to the centre of the thermal by banking nice and tightly. This chart gives us similar information as well, but what it also gives us is the time it takes to do your 360. So if we look at 40 degrees of bank, cruising at 51 knots, it's going to take about 20 seconds to get around a 360. So if you're not sure how well banked you are, try and time your 360. But having said that, look out, airmanship is of prime importance all the time. Can't stress that highly enough. Another thing on the timing as well, those of you who have got averagers on your varios, how long do you set your averager for? I've got no input on that at all. It's just a question, how long does it take you to get around a 360?
Default tends to be around about 20 seconds.
About 20 to 25 seconds, that's right. There we go. Right, another way of judging the angle of bank is a fairly typical instrument panel there. Look at the mounting screws around the ASI. If we take the diagonal of the two screws here, you've got a 45 degree line through there, and similarly on that one as well. So if you're turning to the left, you could line those two screws up with the horizon, and you've got 45 degrees of bank. And similarly, if you're turning to the right, you could line those two screws up. So it's a really good judge of how close you are to your 45 degrees, your optimum. Right, that's my last slide for the time being. I'm going to hand over to Mike now. Like I say, he's the meat in the sandwich. So I'll...
That's not a compliment, is it?
Right, shall I bring this one?
The other simple way of judging the 45 degrees I use is a piece of cardboard that's cut to a right angle. I've stuck it on top of the compass. Any plant that you keep rolling until you've got the piece of card...
There we are. Okay, sir.
Lovely. Thanks, John. So John set the scene with respect to why we're trying to thermal a little more efficiently. I think a lot of people go from the solo stage and beyond and they hit a few thermals and maybe develop a bit of a technique, but it's not very regimented and it's all a bit wish-washy. So what I want to go through is a technique of how to locate the thermal, how to enter, center, and also how to leave. But it's only one method. There's 101 different methods, and you will all develop your own method. So if we go through, what we're trying to do with the thermaling is we're trying to place the glider with a radius around the core of the thermal, the strongest part of the thermal. And what we'll find then is that we will be climbing at a constant rate all the way around, usually. Some thermals are a bit rough, so you may get the exception. But generally speaking, we should have a constant angle of bank and a constant rate of climb all the way around the thermal. Now, a lot of thermaling that we do, initially when you go into the turn, you'll feel a surge and you've got good climb, and further round you've not got quite such a good climb. A lot of people will be happy with that. Oh, we're climbing, overall we're going up at 2 knots. But if there's 4 knots on one side of the thermal, then you can get centred on the 4 knots, and so you'll double your climb rate. And as John said, that ups your cross-country speed, it probably means you're going to get home, etc., etc. So that's what we're trying to actually achieve. How do we do it? That's the crux of the matter. If you ask 10 pundits, how do they actually do their thermaling technique, you probably get 10 different answers. Some people talk, oh, you straighten up here, you then turn so many degrees left or right, and then you straighten for so many seconds. It's never going to work. What you have to do is develop a method for yourself that works with you in your glider at your wing loading. So what we have to take into consideration is we're trying to form, all the 10 pundits will say the same, you're trying to form a mental picture of the thermal. Now, it might seem a bit airy-fairy, but if you can get this image in your mind of where you think the core of the thermal is, where the strong part is, then fly the glider around and centre on that, you're halfway there. If you just try and fly purely by what the instruments are telling you, you'll never do it. You have to get this mental image implanted. So how do we actually get this information to give us this mental map of the thermal? Now, you're probably thinking, well, we just look at the vario and off we go. Ignore that to start with. The body, as you know, you can detect acceleration and deceleration very, very quickly and very small amounts. You've felt yourself going into a thermal and you get the initial surge and then it drops off a bit. You feel that straight away. The vario probably doesn't. So we've got that seat of the pants feeling, and that's what you've got to really work on. That's what you're basing the whole of the technique on. The glider is going to pitch and roll, caused by the turbulence, by the lift in the thermal, etc., etc. More information coming back. So as you're going into the thermal, it might be rolling off to the left, which is saying on the right-hand side is a stronger lift. The noise, we're going flying around, hopefully at a reasonably constant airspeed. So the noise of the glider flying through the air, you should be tuned into that. You shouldn't have to be looking at the airspeed indicator, am I flying fast enough? You know, you should get to the stage where that's perfectly natural and you don't have to think about it. We've got the audio vario, that's going to be chirping at us, so that'll tell us where the strong and the not so strong lift is. But the audio is also driven by the same electronics as the visual vario, therefore we've got limitations on that. Other indications, gliders, birds,
sheep.
We fly in Wales. If you see sheep going up, it's a pretty good thermal. So other gliders are an excellent variometer. They're better than any electronics you'll ever find. If you've got a glider thermaling near you and you can see how fast he's going up, and if the pilot is switched on, he's also in the strongest lift. So that gives you a good start. Finally, the visual vario. Now you might think, we've got all these things that I'm babbling on about, and right at the bottom you've got what maybe you thought you should be looking at. Well, the visual vario has a number of limitations, and the other thing that is a big problem with it, it's in the cockpit. So we're flying around, and if you're looking down at the visual vario, you're not looking out. You will hit somebody. And because your visual perception is very strong, if you're just looking at this instrument, you'll believe what it's telling you. Now, as we'll see now, that might not always be exactly what we want to hear. I'm just going to cover briefly some limitations of instrumentation. You probably know most of these, but it's worth considering at this point just to see how it does affect the thermaling technique. What we've got, there are two main factors that mess up the instrumentation in terms of giving us very quick and accurate information. First is lag. Now, if we imagine we have a glider that weighs, 600-700 pounds, whatever, if you're ballasted, even heavier, you're flying along at a fair old whack, maybe 60 knots, and then you fly into this nice rising air. You imagine that glider has a heck of a momentum, and it's not going to immediately go up. So there's, you know, a second, 2 seconds of delay before it can physically accelerate up. Then we have the change in air pressure is detected by the variometer through a differentiator, and then it gives you the visual and the audio reading. So we're talking of quite a lag. Typically, if your instruments are set up correctly, we're still going to be at about a 2 or 3 second delay in the variometer telling you what the air is actually doing outside, or what you in the glider is doing in that air. So that's okay, you might think 2 or 3 seconds, it's not the end of the world. If we're flying at 50 knots, then we're doing about, rough conversions, 25 meters every second. So if the vario bleeps, that means that 75 meters ago is where the lift was. It's not where we are now. So that's quite an important point to consider. The other point which is worth looking at on your glider is the total energy compensation. Now, if your vario doesn't zero, I fly a number of different gliders and quite often the vario isn't on zero on the ground. Take it out, throw it in the bin and get a decent one. It's as simple as that. It's a total waste of time if it's not zeroed. The other thing which is equally important is total energy compensation. Because we have so much energy in the glider, if we pull the stick back, the glider obviously climbs. If the vario starts indicating climb, that's no good at all. So what we want to be able to get away from what we call stick thermals, where there is no or little total energy compensation. So to summarise, what I'm saying is we've got to develop a feel for what the air is doing and what our glider is doing in that air. If we can do that, we're way ahead of the game, because the instruments are, as we said, 2 or 3 seconds behind. We already know as you go into the thermal, you feel the lift, then that's the indicator. That's what you're doing. You're actually going up. And the instruments you can use to confirm a little later on. One limitation is that humans can only detect acceleration and deceleration. So we can feel the initial surge very well, and we can also feel when the surge dies off. We're good at that bit. The bit in the middle, you can't tell. If you stand in a lift and go up, you don't know whether you're going up or down once it's accelerated. So if you have a constant velocity, you can't feel it. That's when we use the vario, just to check that it is 4 knots and it's not -1 knot. Okay. Does that bit make sense? So that's where we're aiming for. It's this feel. So now let's have a look at how we can implement that. As John mentioned earlier, throughout this, a good lookout at all times is absolutely essential. That's the whole crux of the talk, to be honest. Thermal entry. I'll break it down into 3 stages. Let's go thermal entry, and then the actual centering, and also leaving the thermals. Assuming we've seen a nice cumulus in the glide, you're tootling along, everything's hunky-dory. You expect the lift to be somewhere underneath, but when you actually get to the cloud, you think, oh, that's strange, nothing's happening. nine times out of ten, especially with early airtime pilots, when they're in sort of this stage of development, they look up at the cloud and go, oh, it's not working. What's gone wrong? I'll move on. Because they're not actually underneath the cloud. The cloud up is vertically above you. Okay, so you tend, when you're flying, to look maybe 75, 80 degrees and think that's vertically above you. So your cloud is there and you've flown underneath. You got to this point, you're looking up. Oh, that's not working, we'll go over here. And you've not actually got to the cloud. So that's a basic thing to look out for. Ooh, diagrams, right, here we go. This is where it gets interesting. We've got a thermal shown here in plan view, looking down. It's very, very simplified. I wish thermals were like this. Make it a lot easier. Yeah. So we have a core in the middle, less strong lift around here, and then sink around here. So on the interface between the sink and the initial part of the lift, there'll be a turbulent area all around here. Let's assume that we're coming along, we've seen this nice cumulus, we are actually going to fly right underneath it, and let's have a look what happens. As we enter here, we'll feel the glider actually accelerate because this is sinking air, so the whole thing coming down, that's what gives you the acceleration. So you can feel that slight rush. Remember to say feel, that's the crux of it. As we go through this interface here, you may find there's a little bit of turbulence. It varies on the day, on the instability of the air, etc. Also, how fast you're flying will dictate how long you feel that turbulence. What we're going to do, we're going to fly through this area of lift. So we've had an initial acceleration down through sink, bit of turbulence, but the wings are basically level, and then we feel the glider starting to accelerate upwards. Ignore the vario at the moment. When we get to this point, we should be in the strongest part of the lift. As we fly beyond here, the lift is going to subside slightly. And it's at that point you need to get the turn started, and quite quickly. It's when you feel the lift actually dropping off. Now, if you remember, we were doing the, we'll probably be flying faster than 50 knots, say 60 knots. You're covering a fair bit of ground, fair distance, I should say. And also, you've got the 3 second lag in the vario. So if you wait for the vario, you watch it going up like that, and you think, oh, right, it's starting to drop off now. You're not going to be there. You're going to be somewhere out here. Okay, so you've got to do that initial turn when you, as soon as you feel, almost before the lift drops away, you can feel it surging, and then it'll just drop slightly, and then you into the weaker lift, and then the sink, and that's when you've got to get the first turn in. If we're head on, then we can turn either way. It's actually easier when we hit the thermal from the side. What we're looking to do is try and set up a coordinated turn with a constant angle of bank and constant airspeed, because we're trying to get this mental picture of where the thermal is, where the core is. If we put on a load of bank and take it off and the airspeed's up and down, it's very hard to interpret what the air is doing and what you're doing. So try and get a nice coordinated turn. Either way, as I say, if the wings are level and we've hit it in the middle. And what we're doing as we go around one turn, we're mapping where the lift is. So we'll come, let's assume that we turn right, we're going to hit this surge, we put on some bank, we come out through the weaker lift, we might even go into the sink, hopefully not, and then we come round and then we're back into the core again. So we're going to have strong lift on this section and not so strong lift on that section. And if you carry on just doing that, that's probably what most of you have found at early stages. You've got the strong lift on one side, and then it's not so strong on the other side. Strong lift again, and as I say, a lot of people are happy with that. But there's much, much better lift to be had, or climb rates to be had, if we can get centered on the core. Be decisive. I see so many people They're going along, there's a bit of a thermal, oh, I wonder what's happening, oh, maybe I should turn, I don't know, I'll have a sandwich first. And, you know, it's all happening, it's all gone, it's way back. So be decisive, look at the cloud, decide where you're going to go under that cloud. So I'll cover a little bit of recognition of the thermal under the cloud later. And stick to your plan. If it doesn't work, then try something else. But have a plan and actually fly the glider around that plan. Okay, that was assuming that we intercepted straight on. If we intercept from the side, we get a bit more information which helps us form the mental picture of where this thing is. So assuming we're coming in here, we again go through the sink, turbulence, and then it starts lifting. And if we put in a turn here, we can go, if we move along, then the lift drops off. So we're going to put in the turn, exactly the same theory. You go in, you feel the surge, it goes up. As soon as it drops off, turn. But this time, because the thermal, the stronger part of the thermal is on the right-hand side, if you're in tune with the glider and you're not fighting the thing all the way, you're feeling what the glider's telling you, you'll feel it nudge you. It's actually trying to push you away because the stronger lift is there, weaker lift on this side. Therefore, as the glider goes in, it'll roll to the left slightly. Now, some days it's very, very subtle. Other days, especially in strong conditions, you know, it can push you right out. So, but that's good because we now know the core is on the right-hand side. So we're going to do exactly the same, wait for the lift to just stop increasing, put the turn in and do this exploratory turn. So we're going around a whole 360 and we're seeing where the lift is the strongest and where it's weakest. And then we've got to get that into our map, mental map, and then move the centering across to that. So again, same theory. It's not if it's this, do that, if not, do this. Exactly the same principle. Coordinated turns, constant airspeed. If you can't fly a coordinated turn, go and learn how to do it so that you've got constant bank, constant airspeed all the way around, because then the differences are caused by the thermal and not by your flying. Right, I mentioned earlier that we're aiming for this constant lift all the way around the turn. That's going to occur when we're going around this, describing this circle here. So let's assume that we've put in a turn, we've come round, and we're now describing that path. What you'll find is strong lift here as we come round, weaker lift, strong lift, weaker lift. So we know that we need to shift that across there. And that's all there is to it. Okay. If we've turned the wrong way, because, for example, turbulence didn't allow you to detect which wing was going higher, exactly the same principle applies. And what we'll do then is we'll probably turn out, we'll go through the sink, back into the lift, sink, lift. But again, you know, lift there, sink there, so the centre of the thermal is off to that side. How do we know to build this map, you need a reference point? Now, different people use different methods. One useful one to use, I don't know whether you can remember that. Yeah, you don't actually need to see the sun as such, just the brighter part. If you're good at looking at the terrain and seeing, I mean, around here the beacons stick out pretty well. So, you know, as we're going around the turn, the stronger lift was over towards the beacons or away from the beacons. So you can use that as a reference. If you're over flatlands, then the sun is easier because it'll shine through the clouds anyway. So you've got the brighter part and the not so brighter part. So it just gives you an anchor point to build this picture on. Okay, so we've done this first exploratory turn. Now we're going to get the thing centered. And all we're doing, we're trying to displace a circle, this nice coordinated turn that we're doing. We're trying to displace it in the direction where the core is. And we've got all the information coming through. So one thing that, one little rule that I'd always try and adhere to, don't ever fly through the same area of sync twice. It's just lazy flying. Okay, if you come around here and you go through the sync, don't think, oh, I don't know what happened. Oh yes, it's still sync, because it'll probably be stronger this time. Okay, don't just change something, you know, turn the other way. Do something, just. So, this is what we were aiming for. We're centered on the core. We've got a constant value of lift all the way around. And usually it's smoother as well. So if the thing's pitching up and down and up and down, don't say, oh, it's very rough today. It probably wasn't if you were centered on the core. The first turn was just an exploration, and we were actually going to do a complete 360, and then we're going to start moving it. That's easier to work with mentally to begin with. What will happen later is that you're not going to bother doing the whole turn before you start correcting, because you'll be picking up the information more quickly and you'll be able to put on more and more bank, or take off bank, whichever is required. So as experience comes, rather than doing a whole 360, maybe you do half a 360 and then do a correction, and then maybe a quarter of a turn, and then maybe an eighth, and it gets down to its continual corrections all the way around. So that's what you're aiming for. So I've said, let's move the circle across. It sounds very easy. The easiest way to do it is simply take off some roll and then put some roll back on again. Now remember, we're doing, what was it, 25 meters a second at 50 knots. You don't have to do it for very long to move, displace the circle. The thing to remember is that if you're turning round here, if you say, oh, right, I want to take the roll off here, you're still going to go a fair way round before it straightens, because of the delay. You're up at hopefully 45 degrees or whatever's required. You'd think, oh, I'll straighten the glider up and now I'll roll it back. Well, going from 45 degrees to flat takes a number of seconds. So you've actually still come round the corner a little bit. So you've got to kind of preempt. I want to move it over there. So you need to flatten the turn a little earlier than perhaps you think. Does that bit make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. You can steepen the turn, and you'll probably find as you get more experience with it, you'll do that. Rather than flattening it, you may well steepen the turn, so that rather than describing a circle coming around here, you might, as you're falling out there, you might think, right, I need to get back into this bit. So rather than coming right the way out and then round, you'll actually increase the angle of bank to come round like that. But again, that's all down to experience, but it's getting this mental picture and feeling what the glider is telling you. Okay, we've covered that. We keep going on about coordinated turns, etc., etc. There's a little example here. If you can't read it or not. If we fly half of a turn at 45 degrees of bank and 45 knots, and we just change that a tiny bit, so just you let the airspeed creep up 5 knots and the bank roll off by 5 degrees, so it's next to nothing. We move the centre of where we're circling by 26 metres, which is quite significant, especially if, you know, imagine the size of some of the thermals. So it doesn't take a lot of change of roll angle or airspeed to move the whole circle. One thing that's worth noting is that if you try and thermal in this area where you're not centred, it's going to be forever trying to push you away, because the strong going around here, the left wing is in stronger lift than the right wing, therefore it's rolling you to the right and it's trying to push you away all the time. Once you get centred, that doesn't apply. So it's easy. You just go round and round and round. Up you go. So they say. It's the feel of the glider. It's the information that's coming through your seat. And once you're actually centred and you're trying to do the finer adjustments, then use the visual vario. Just glance at that as a confirmation. You think you're in 8 knots, whereas in fact you may only be in 2. Whatever. That's the only use. So now we've found a thermal, we've done this exploratory turn, and we've moved the circle so that we're actually going round the centre. And you may think, well, that's it, that's sorted. I'll just stay in here and go to cloud base and off we go. Of course, thermals aren't quite that shape, especially if they go through a shear layer, then they're going to be distorted. This process is an iterative thing. You have to keep doing it all the way to the top of the climb to maintain yourself in the best lift. Okay, if we lose the thermal, now it's for one of two reasons. You could have either just flown out of the thermal itself because you didn't map it properly, or you could have dropped out of the bottom of the thermal, in which case you can't do anything about it. If you've a really good reason to move on, then forget the thermal and try for the next one. But if you've lost the thermal through inaccurate flying, all that will happen is you'll get to the next one and lose that, and then the next one and lose that, and then land. So generally, if you've lost the thermal, there's a good chance that we're pretty close to it, so you may as well try and find it again. As a rule of thumb, search up wind, because as the thermal rises, column of air rising here, we're thermaling around. We're dropping down through that air mass. Just hopefully that air mass is taking us up quicker than we're coming down. So the chances are you're going to drop out, especially if there's any shear, you're going to drop out on the downwind side of it. So if you lose the thermal, go upwind initially. If you hadn't dropped out the downwind side of it, the most likely place for the next thermal to be is exactly where that one's triggered from. And quite often you'll get a bubble going and then another bubble behind it. So although you've fallen out of one bit, there's probably another one coming up straight behind it. If you've missed that one, well, then we've got to move on. All we do then is start from scratch. We've got to centre, get the thing centred, get the climb established nice and smooth, move it all across, get a mental picture of it, and we repeat the process. All right, I've covered that. Thermal exit. John said that for the achieved rate of climb, it's from the end of the cruise coming into the thermal to the start of the cruise in the next one. So thermal exit is very important. Again, you'll see people, they're up at cloud base and they're just wafting around and shall I go? Oh, I might go. And they sort of wander out here and then they think, oh yes, it's going down now. We'll go. And off they go. So that's 200 feet you've just lost, which you work quite hard to get. One simple way, assuming I've put on there that there are no other gliders at your thermaling height. All we're going to do is tighten up the final turn. And what this is going to do is enable us to get the speed on for our exit whilst we're travelling through the core of the thermal. So we're trying to get the nose down, we're trying to get the speed on, and by doing that we can do this very inefficient part of the flying going through the strongest part of the lift. If you just come out the side here and then go, oh yeah, okay, we'll go. You've done all that horrible, inefficient, getting the nose down, getting the airspeed on, in sync as well. So the efficient way, tighten up, go across the core, get the speed on. And then when we exit here, we're going to be pretty well at cloud base and at cruise speed for going to the next one. So we're high, and we've got the speed. If you come round here and do it, you're 300 feet lower. And you look at this guy and think, well, I was thermaling with him. How come he's up there? And chances are all he did was that. Okay. One thing that's worth considering whilst you're climbing, apart from doing all this mental picture and moving your circle and flying accurately, with your spare mental capacity, decide on the track you're going to take whilst you're climbing to your next thermal. Because when you're down below cloud base, it's much, much easier to look at the next cloud and get a good idea of whether it's going to be any good or not. If you're at cloud base near the wispies, you can't even see the next cloud. So have a look and you're thinking, right, well, I'm going to be heading, you know, towards the beacons or towards Abergavenny or wherever you're going, generally in that direction, and do that as you're climbing. One point you can do is look to try and judge how far the next cloud is. It's very hard. You've got this cloud, I don't know, is it a mile, is it 3 miles? So look at the shadow on the ground, and then you can think, well, I've got to fly to that point on the ground to get underneath that cloud, you know, give it a heck of it with the sun. And that's much easier to use than trying to judge it in the air. Okay, one point also. When we're climbing, you probably found today that the lift was in a certain part. You've got the cloud, the sun, and the wind, and generally the lift is in an area, maybe into sun, into wind, something like that. And what you'll find is that throughout the day, that will hold for most of the clouds. So if you've gone under, let's assume that's a cloud rather than a thermal now, if you've gone under this cloud and we found that the lift was on in that position, given, you know, north, wind, sun, etc., it was in that sort of position, which may be the southwest corner of the cloud, then the next cloud you go to that area first, because the chances are that's where it's going to be working. And as I say, that holds for usually the day, unless something changes. You might get, you know, if the wind changes, okay, as the sun goes over, it'll change slightly. But during the window, the 6 hours that we're flying, then that's worth remembering. John's covered the angle of bank. I'll just reiterate what he's saying, because it is so important that you get the actual angle of bank cranked up a little bit. The classic thing for UK pilots certainly is they don't thermal tight enough. They 20 degrees, 30 degrees sometimes, you'll see it. As John says, you're reducing your turning radius radically for a very, very small amount of increase in sink rate. So there's nothing to lose. You want to be up around here generally. If it's a very, very light, very wafty thermal, then maybe 20 degrees is what you need, because if you go any more, you're not going to climb. But if it's got anything going for it, I mean, the thermal's got to be going up at 20 degrees. It's got to be going up more than 1.2 knots air mass for us to climb. It's only got to be going up more than 2 knots for us to climb at that angle of bank. But obviously, at a higher angle of bank, a smaller turning radius, you can get in on the core where the strength, the thermal strength is going to be higher. The angle of bank in the initial turn can be influenced how high you are above the ground. If you're very low, now when I say low, that's to the trigger source of the thermal. Now, in the flatlands, it's easy, it's the ground. But if you're flying in the Alps or the Pyrenees or somewhere, that source might be at 10,000 feet. And okay, we're only at 10,500 feet, but the, you know, the thermals only had 500 feet of altitude to get going. So relative to the actual triggering source, the lower it is, or the closer to the trigger source you are, the smaller is the thermal, and therefore you need more angle of bank. But also you're closer to the ground. So be careful of that. As the thermal goes up and rises, it expands, and therefore the first turn that you make can maybe be a little bit shallower which might be easier initially to fly more accurately. Yeah, I've said that already, haven't I? If we, you sometimes see pilots, they're up at 60 degrees of angle. Now, occasionally that will work if you're in a very, very strong thermal, because or you can look at it from this graph here. If we were at 45 degrees, if the air mass is going up more than 2 knots with quids in, we're actually going to be going up. If we're at sort of, we're always 60 degrees, 65 knots here, the air mass has got to be going up at 4 knots for us to even climb. So beyond, there's this sort of threshold area around here. You can see 40, 45 degrees. That's, if you fly it at 45 degrees, most of the time you'll be near the optimum.
There's quite a difference in G loading as well, then, right? You're going
yes.
from 1.1 G to basically 2 G.
Yeah, flying there is horrible. It's horrible. And if you're a passenger with somebody flying there, it's even more horrible. It really is. Okay. What sort of speeds to fly at in a thermal? It depends, obviously, on the glider, the wing loading. You need enough speed to have quick roll control. Now, I've flown with quite a few people and they go, oh, you fly a bit fast, you know, you're doing sort of 50 knots or what have you. You know, I'm thermal at 40 in the 21 or whatever. And you think, well, yeah, apart from being on the back end of the polar, where you're probably in increased sink anyway, the roll rate at 40 knots is just horrendous. So it's waffling around, you haven't got precise control. But if you go up to 50 knots, which is giving you a tiny, tiny increase in sink rate, but you've got nice coordinated controls, and you can feel then more information coming back, which helps us build this mental picture. Okay. Accuracy. I've already said don't bimble around. Don't bimble around. Okay. Have an idea where you want it to go. And you fly the glider there. Don't just sort of, what's happening here? You know, that's where I want to be. That's the best part. The chances are it's going to try and turn you away from the best part of the lift. So that's where you want to go. Then make it do it. More don't bumbling around, yeah. This carries across to going for the next thermal as well, which I know John talks about in a minute. Have an idea of which thermal, which cloud usually you're going to aim for as you're climbing, and go for it. Unless something really radical happens in the meantime, like you see a glider a little off track climbing very well, then go for the cloud that you said. Have the plan. At least then you can sit in the field and say, well, at least I had a plan. One final thing, the preparation, as John said earlier, it is practice, practice, practice. Developing this idea of this mental image of the thermal, you can't do it the first time you fly or the second. You've got to do it, you know, a lot of thermaling, and then it'll start building. But if you're working on the right ideas to start with, i.e. the response of the glider, etc., the feel, then you're in with a chance of doing it. To give you your best chance, though, make sure your glider's all okay. It flies properly. There are no ifs and buts. Get it sorted, and then you can start really going places. And the instrumentation, make sure it all works. The total energy compensation I mentioned earlier, no leaks, but how do we know that? What it should do, as you increase speed, then the vario should, if we're flying at whatever, 50 knots, the vario should be at, you know, 1.5 knots of down in zero lift. As we increase the speed to a higher airspeed, the vario needle should just smoothly go down to that new sink rate corresponding. Say we went up to 70 knots and we get three knots of a sink rate of 3 knots. So the vario should just go very smoothly down to 3 knots. So we're now flying at 70 and it says 3 knots down. That's working properly. there's going to be two things that will be wrong. It can overshoot, where we put the speed on and the vary will come down, and it won't stop at 3 knots, it'll go down to 5, and it'll come back up to 1, and then down to 4, and then back to 3. And that is really hard, because as you're pulling up into a thermal and then you're looking to see what sort of value we're getting, it'll probably be saying 8 knots and we're only actually climbing at 2. So that's if you've got too little compensation. That's usually caused by a leak in the plumbing. As long as your tube is correct on the back and it's plumbed in properly, then you've probably got a leak. So the total energy compensation given from the Brunswick's tube is being reduced. Therefore, it's not full total energy compensation. If it undershoots or lags, the chances are there's water in the plumbing. If you leave your glider out overnight, it's very easy to get water in there, and that's probably the cause. Final part on mine. Actually go out and fly 45 degree bank turns, having done all the checks before, at a constant airspeed. And make sure you can do it. Don't just do one, oh, that's it, that's sorted. You know, do 3, 4, 5. Make sure you can nail it each time. The other thing is, turn both ways. How many people do you find, I can turn left, but I can't turn right? Okay, well, 50% of the thermals you're gonna need to turn right in. So you're throwing away 50% straight away. So do it both ways. And what I tend to do, everybody has a natural preference, and what I do is, if I find myself turning right more than left, I just say, right, for half an hour I'm not allowed to turn right, and you know, for thermaling, and so it soon comes back. So you need to get to the stage where it doesn't matter which side you're going, you're as coordinated, left or right. Little things you can do here, I mean, it's a brilliant place to learn the thermaling technique. Okay, we have ridge and we have wave, blah blah blah. But we can use those to enable us to practice with the thermals. So what we can do is we can run along, find a climb, then run along, find another climb, and we can use the ridge as a safety net. So go on the ridge, get a bit of height, fly out into the valley, or we can pull the brakes, try and find the centre of the thermal again. Once you've gone to cloud base, if you're not going to go cross country or anything, then fly away a little bit, pull the brakes, go down a bit, and then come back and actually find the thermal and climb back up again, because you've just been there. And if you do it within glide of towel, then you, if it doesn't work, you've got to get out. If you do climb on the ridge, fly it away, fly out into the valley, and try and stay up on thermals alone. You're not allowed to come back to the ridge. That's it. And okay, last thing, it's not working, so go back to the ridge and top up and then do it again. So then you'll be flying purely in thermal, so you're going to have to be centering properly and climbing. And if you can soar in thermals like that, you can go cross country. That's all it is. It's just, rather than flying from one thermal and back, you just fly onto the next. Ah, and that's the end of it. Did that make sense?
Yeah. Yeah. Very good.
Okay. Back to Mr. Clark.
Thanks, Mike. Right.
Thank you.
Look at the sky. These pictures, actually, they look a lot better on the monitor than they do on the screen, which is a little bit unfortunate. But looking at the sky is the crucial bit. What we're really interested in is the cloud bases. Now, we've got two fairly adjacent clouds here. There's actually a street running through here and off into that distance. There's a break in the middle. But we've got two similar clouds there, but quite contrasting appearance when you look at them closely. Look at the base of this one compared to the base of this one. This one's hard and flat and dark, and this one's gone all wishy-washy and soft and wallowy. And so you really do need to look very carefully at the bases, or sky full of clouds, but look at the clouds very carefully. I was at a comp a little while back, and Andy Davis was there. It was at Bidford. We had a non-flying day, and he asked Andy Davis has been world champion on two occasions. Asked Andy if he'd do a little talk for the assembled masses. He put a photograph of a cloud up on the screen, and he talked with fascination for about an hour on that one cloud, putting out different aspects of the cloud. And it points out bits and pieces that I'd never considered before. But that's Andy Davis as world champion. What I'm saying here is look at the clouds very carefully, look at the bases. This would be the cloud to go for. Give that one a miss. Okay. Look at the sky again. Now, we've got a lovely street starting here and running out way off into the distance here. How are you going to get to it from where we are here? This is a bit of a ragged looking cloud. Mike's talked about sink and turbulence on the edge. Look at these whispers here. There's got to be something going up under there. So if you're going from here, flying into the picture, it's worth a detour under those whispers on your route to this street over here. Again, looking at the small detail. Look at the clouds carefully. When you get fairly high, within 1,000 feet of cloud base, you've lost the opportunity then to look at the cloud tops, and they're equally important. If you can see good billowing tops out of your cloud and you've got a nice dark base, odds on that cloud's going to be working quite nicely. So as well as looking at the bases carefully, when you can, when you lower down, if you've got more than about 4 or 5/8 of cloud and you're up near cloud base, you're not going to see the tops anyway. But if it's a day with 2/8, 3/8, something like that, and you're a little bit lower down, you've got a chance to see the tops as well. But the bases are really the big clues. There's a familiar field. Mid-morning, looking at the cloud shadows, and we're all sitting on the ground wondering what the day's going to bring. But look at the sky again. Look at that cloud over there. We should have been launching 20 minutes ago. Yeah, that sky is working, and we should have been off and away. We're going to look at the ground now. Now, as you look at the countryside, we've got a whole massive countryside there. And what have we got? We've got towns, we've got forests, we've got lakes, we've got little villages, we've got sunshine, and we've got shadow as well. Every one of those edges, whether it's out here, in here, there's a temperature difference there. And that temperature difference is enough to trigger off a thermal. There's loads of books. The book I've been using for quite a long time is called Beyond Gliding Distance. I got it from the BGA about 5 or 6 years ago. It might be out of print now. But on just this one slide alone, there's virtually a whole chapter just on looking at ground sources. It's a huge area to look at. But let's imagine now we've got a wind coming from the 10 o'clock position. Where's your biggest temperature differential going to be on this? I'd suggest we've got a town here and we've got a lake here and it's in the sun. This town is going to be cooking. The lake is going to be cold. Langhorse Lake didn't warm up very much all through the summer. You've got this big bubble of warm air being blown along by the wind. It hits this big slug of cold, stable air here, and the warm air rises up over the cold air and it's on its way to being a thermal. Another good source. We've got a cloud shadow here, which again is being blown along by the wind. A little village here has been sitting in the sunshine. Under the cloud shadow, you've got cold air being blown along. Reaches this warm part here, and the cold air will slide underneath the warm air, and that warm air is up and away. That's your start to your thermal again. So when you're in a position where you're looking at the ground for sources, you're looking at the biggest difference in temperature that you can see on the ground. On top of all this, you've got undulations in the ground, you've got hills which are facing the sun, you've got valleys which are sheltered from the wind. All those bits can give you that temperature boost which would potentially kick a thermal off. When to look at the ground and when to look at the sky. If you're in the top half of the convective layer, you really need to be looking at the sky. If you're in the bottom half of the convective layer, then's the time to be looking at the ground. So if you've got a 5,000 foot cloud based day, if you're above 2,500 feet, forget the ground. You're on your way, look at the sky. Below 2,500 feet, look at ground sources. You might be thinking of finding areas potentially for field landing perhaps. So you're looking at thermal sources and for field landings as well. So that halfway mark in the convective layer is your cutoff point between looking at the sky and looking at the ground. I think that's probably about it. I've been looking for some snappy little slide just to finish off, and really it comes down to that and all that lot, really. So, any questions at all for Mike or me? Or it's one of these topics that you could go on talking about for ages, and it's nowhere to draw the line, really.
So there's a bit of a choice between when you're just trying to centre your circle, between avoiding the worst bit and going for the best bit, isn't there?
Yeah.
So you can either turn on worst sink, or which do you do and when, or best lift?
As Mike said if earlier on, if you ask 10 cross-country pilots how they go about it, you'll get 10 different answers. Personally, as I'm going around my 360, if I'm pointing towards Langhorse Lake and I get my surge in the lift and I'm circling around to the right, and then the lift is worst when I'm pointing away from Langhorse Lake, what I would try and do is to straighten my turn up before I'm pointing at Langhorse Lake next time. Just straighten up for just a couple of seconds and then continue the turn. Because my lift is on the left, I'm circling right, as I'm pointing towards Langhorse Lake, my lift is on the left, so I want to move my circle that way. So in that situation you've described, I'm looking at markers. Mike mentioned using the sun, but Langhorse Lake is a good one. There's usually good markers on the ground, and there's things in the sky as well as the sun. You can say, well, that cloud, it's working quite well as you come round, I head in towards that cloud. So it's one of those things that you develop a feel for it, and it's something you just have to work at to get the feel, really. Bit of a waffly answer, so any help? Yes, Mike?
John, one of the sort of classic BGA methods for centering thermals that you read about is this idea of tightening up in the stronger lift,
yeah,
and reducing the angle of bank when the lift is weaker.
Yeah.
So that's not likely to be the quickest way to centre?
No, the BGA do, that is the method that they recommend for teaching, because it's relatively easy to, I always found it very difficult, but it is relatively easy to teach, because you can monitor the vario and you can give instruction, tighten, take it off, tighten on the vario readings. It's not the quickest way in, but it is a method which is relatively easy to teach. We know from teaching the basics, we get people to teach in speed control, don't look at the ASI. You work on attitude, and once you think the attitude is right, you confirm it with ASI because of instrument lag. And similar with thermaling, there's a lag on the instruments. If you can develop this feel that Mike was talking about, you'll be so much more ahead of the game, and then use the instruments to confirm what you think. And they probably will confirm that you are right. So you do have to, one of the early slides, it does take a lot of hard work, a lot of practice, a lot of concentration. But if you can put the time in to develop that feel, it pays dividends later on. Being thermal, having to think about it too much, you know, you're on a winter, you've got that spare capacity for route planning and looking at the next cloud. Yeah.
I don't know if it's lecture number two, but could you say anything about using flaps in thermaling?
Ooh, where?
All right, that is
I'm still learning. I'm still learning. When I started flying the Nimbus, Jerry gave me a bit of advice. He said, centre without using the flap, zero flap. Once you're centred, then would be the time to actually slow down, which will give you a smaller turning circle. So once you're centred, then you would start to think about deploying your flaps to actually help with reduce the turning circle. So centre first where you've got best manoeuvrability with zero flap. So do your centering with zero flap, and then think about deploying thermal flap once you're centred. Jerry, being the font of all knowledge, yes, I would tend to agree with that. I mean, it does vary so much from glider to glider as well. Nimbus has got, you know, 6 flap settings, so and actually the roll control is actually quite good on the first setting of positive flap, so I do actually do my thermal centering with the first section, first setting deployed, but then as I am centered, then the flaps go down more and the speed comes back,
And then they're basically the reverse on the way out? Because you can lose...
Yes.
You lose height and stuff.
You do. Mike described of tightening, again, good luck out, your airspace is clear. You can tighten and come through the centre of the thermal. That's when my flaps go up. Again, if you try to accelerate, just take, if you try to accelerate with the flaps still down in a positive position, it's like someone's holding you back by the braces. You know, you're trying to put the nose down. But if you put the flaps up as you tighten the turn, and level the wings. It's as I level the wings, I might put the flaps then, and the glider just accelerates, you know, without having to work at it really, especially if it's full of water. That's a nice feeling then.
Transitioning between Thurmaline and Dolphin.
Right. What, with flaps?
No, just normally flying, so right. Going cross country.
Yeah.
The thermal up to higher.
Yeah.
When do you start doing dolphining and not taking the turns? And
it's going to depend on the height band, but say a good cross-country day, 5,000 feet cloud base. If I'm in that top 1,000 feet, I'd be sort of dolphining then. And that's also when flaps come to play, because flaps will extend your speed range. You know, on the Nimbus, my speed range is 40 knots for thermaling and 80 knots for the cruise. That's without water. Yeah, once you ballast it up, it obviously goes a lot higher. So my speed range is 40 knots. So, as you pull into the thermal, you hit the thermal set 80 knots and pull up. You do see some people doing quite extreme pull-ups. There's an argument that that's a good way of doing it, and there's also an argument, counter-argument, that's not efficient, because as you go through the pitch change, you induce a lot of drag with a sudden pitch change. But as you pull up, certainly in the Nimbus, and the speed starts to come off, you can start to lower the flaps as the speed reduces, and you can feel the glider kiting on up. And as you come over the top, again, as you want to accelerate, then the flaps go up, they go negative, which allows the acceleration nice and crisp and clean. But in that top 1,000 feet on a good day, if I'm below that 1,000 feet, then I'm looking to, you know, gain a bit more height, get into that top level again. Okay, thanks, Jeff. Sorry, Jill.
Mine was a much more basic question.
Yeah.
How do you resist starting to turn every single bit of lift? That's not a basic question.
That's no bad thing. I think when I did my 50K, it took me, I think, about 3 hours, you know, for my first 50K. So on that basis, to do a 300 is going to take, yeah.
It took me 6.5.
I think that's just something that comes with practice. You do learn to read the clouds, and you can see a couple of clouds ahead, and you think, well, that last cloud that looked like that one, that worked. I had 4 knots under that one. So this little wispy one here, I'm going to ignore that. I'm going to go, as Mike said, have a plan. That one will be working. I'm going to go for it. I'm going to make it work. So I think that just comes with confidence and with, you know, with practice, really, and time. And the hard work and concentration.
What you can do is set the bands to fly in. What I tend to do is cloud base is at whatever height, and I'll say below, say 1,000 feet below cloud base, I'm not going to turn unless I hit something really, really strong. And so I'll just divert and pull up, doing the dolphin that Jeff was talking about. And only when I get down to that height will I take a climb. And then only, you know, I'll set arbitrary figures depending on the day. So maybe 4 knots is all I'm going to take. And then a bit lower than that, well, I'll take 3 knots. Then a bit lower until then you have a band from ground to whatever height you're happy with. And then I'll say, I'll take anything. It doesn't matter where it is. So, but it's going from anything to I'm not taking. And it's just done in bands like that. And they're actual figures. You know, you say, well, below 3,000 feet, I'm not going to stop unless I hit this. So when you drive into 2 knots and you're 500 feet below cloud base, you don't stop. You just pull up a little bit and then push on.
Just slow down as you go through the lift and then push on out the other side.
But don't you need to do a turn in it to see how strong it is?
Well, if you're at that sort of height, so you don't actually... Because every circle that you do is about a kilometre. So if you're doing lots of circles, that's eating into the time and the distance that you could be flying. If you're chasing a 300K you know, badge flight, for example. That's really why the FAI, the badges, we've got silver and we've got gold, and it's a huge step between a 50k silver distance and a 300k for a gold flight, which is why the BGA introduced their 100k diploma. And the 100k diploma is in two pieces, two legs. One is to actually do a flight of 100k, and the second part is to do it at a speed better than 60 kph, handicap speed. And the reason for that, we mentioned earlier on that the thermal day is limited, 5 or 6 hours. So if you're going to do a 300k flight and a 5 hour a day, you've got to be doing better than 60 kph, which is why the 100k diploma is set at that. Sorry, I've gone off thread. What's the question again?
No, well, it's
been a long day.
You hit a patch of lift, and you think, well, is it, you know, it might be a six-up day, but you don't really know how strong that patch of lift is until you've done a circle.
Depends really whether you need the lift or not. Mike was talking earlier about you fly under the cloud and you go for it head on. Now, if you're dolphin flying, you're in that high comfort zone. You don't really need the lift, but you'll take anything that comes along. That would be a good reason then for hitting the thermals head on, because all you're going to do is fly into it. You're going to slow down as you go through it and then speed up on the other side. If you're in the lower level and you think, well, I really need a climb here, then you're better off actually going into the clouds or under the clouds, slightly off to one side. Because if you're slightly off to one side, I know the thermal's going to be on my right. That's the way I'm going to go. And although Mike said he's quite right, you shouldn't have a preference for going right or left. If you're in desperation mode and you know, well, actually, thermal, I'd climb better to the right, okay, attack that cloud so that you are going to be turning right when you go for it. You can use these weaknesses, if you like, to your advantage sometimes. But if you're in that top level, just take the climb, cruise, and then press on. If you're lower down, then explore and take the climb if it proves to be a good one.
What you'll see a number of people doing in that situation, which I found quite useful, is you'll feel the lift, you'll pull up, and if you think it might be worth taking, do a little bit of a deviation. So if you want to, you can continue into a turn, and if it doesn't materialise into something strong enough, you just roll back and you carry on. So you've done a very small deviation, but you've sampled a big chunk of air. And that's, for speed, that's quite handy.
Yeah.
There's a bit in the Reichman book, a lot of us have over the years, which is actually not efficient to climb the top part of the band anymore, to circle, because the lift tending to drop off as you get nearer the cloud base.
Depends on the day, because quite often you'll get...
As a model, you're saying is you should actually fly further but get lower and take the stronger part of the lift.
Certainly for the optimum speed, you should fly from cloud base down to almost the ground, and then take the thermal back to cloud base and on again, because then you've only got one centering or one finding of the thermal compared to maybe taking 10. But don't ring me up for the retrieve, because you've been...
I'm not that brave.
How far off track do you accept going to slow the better
end? You can go quite a long way. There are figures on this. I think it's once you go more than about 30 degrees off track, then it becomes... becomes it's inefficient. It's got to be a good climb to make it worth. You can. Can we draw on the board, Phil?
You have to lift it.
Yeah, okay.
Otherwise, it's once only.
You can, if you're going from here to here, straight line, and you want to detour off a good cloud here, and then go back to there. If you radius that back, and then you radius that one back, that's the extra distance that you've done. Yeah. It's actually not very much. But once you start going 30 degrees or more, then it becomes significant. And if the other thing as well, I think Reichman says, if you are going to detour off track, the sooner you do it, the more effective it is, or the more efficient it is.
Yeah.
And also, if there's a crosswind, you might be more tempted to divert upwind, crosswind, than downwind.
Yeah.
Because by the time you find that thermal, if you've got a crosswind and you're diverting crosswind into wind while you're climbing, you're going to be drifting back on track.
Back in, going the wrong way.
Whereas if you go downwind, while you're climbing, you're drifting further off track even.
Yeah. If your course is from here to here, but the wind is this way, you've got cloud streaks which you're doing all this sort of thing. Whether you do that or... Whoops, not drawn very straight. Those two distances are actually the same. So if you can do your... go along the streets or down the streets if you go any other way, sort of with the wind. If you find lift, go into wind or downwind. Line yourself up with the wind if you find lift. And when you're in sync, go crosswind. And that will take you sort of up the streets. And then you come to the end of the street, go directly crosswind, find the next street and go up. So if you find lift, head into wind or downwind, depending on which way you're going. But line yourself up with the wind. Once you find lift. We're heading towards talking about blue days, but I'll say we start off thinking we talk to silver pilots first of all, and it
so just normally sends them on the first 50 cats up for a blue day.
Not on a blue day, no. It really is one of those topics you can just go on and on and on. And that leads into cross-country flying and tactics and racing and all sorts of stuff. So,
thank you very much.
You're welcome. Any more questions at all? No, everyone getting hungry, sleepy. Right, thank you all for coming.
Thanks, John.
Thanks very much. Okay, thank you.
All and away, I shall soar on my